Hallelujah. He's a good, good Father. Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. How many is ready to praise God this morning?
Yeah.
You know, despite what we're going through, what you're going through, despite how you feel in your body, He's still worthy.
Yeah.
Amen.
Right.
Hallelujah. The Lord is always worthy. Glory to God. Come on, let's stand to our feet and let's bless Him because He is. Bless the Lord, the great I am. Amen. He's whatever you need Him to be. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So come on and praise God with me this morning. Hallelujah. Yes.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. Glory to God.
To join us in services with the PL Arts to receive today's message.
Come with an open heart and an obedient spirit. God will meet you where you're at.
May the spirit of revelation, knowledge, and the power of the Holy Spirit reside in you and in our souls.
That the church He said it's not a pastoral ministry.
That's right.
He said it's not a pastoral ministry.
I agree.
Because what happens is, what people do is they rely only solely on the pastor.
That's wrong.
And that's why a lot of times health conditions happen. It's because everybody relies on the pastor. That happens because, or we can record the message, it's fine, but it happens because the older church, because in times they always had one person. In slavery time, they would use a one person to echo what was said from the slave master. And so they had, when he put the pastor in place to teach to the slaves, they had one voice, one sound, and whatever he said, it just went. Because they did not ever want the body of Christ to organize. See, when you organize, you can cohesively build something.
Yeah.
Imagine if Bishop Joe went out there and started digging in the ground to build us a church. So all of a sudden he gets it and start digging the ground, and then all of a sudden he goes to one area and build another pillar, and then he takes some wood and he makes some concrete, put it in there, and put the stick. It would take a very, very long time to build the sanctuary. Would you agree?
Right. We never build.
Right. And what happened is over time, through inclement weathers and tiredness, you would get tired, and the foundation of the church would never be able to build because it was one person, one man, trying to build it all alone. But then all of a sudden his wife comes in, and all of a sudden she started making sure that things were structured correctly. And then Lene comes in and say, okay, I can do this part. And then we have Brother Al come in and say, like, let's hold the wall up. And then, you know, Antonio, all this stuff started coming in place. And all of a sudden we start seeing dimensions of a foundation being built. And then I come in place, I build the other side. You have Pastor Damien, we have many others. They start building. Next thing you know, we erect the wall. And then all of a sudden we say, okay, now let's go ahead and put the rooftop on top of it. And then all of a sudden we have a structure of a building. And then the women all get together with their ideas and the way they beautify things. And all of a sudden they start dressing the things out. If you know, like right now, you got poinsettias and different things in place that it wasn't here before. But because of the season, because you know when a woman's handiwork is in place, because guess what? Ain't no man going to the store buying no poinsettias. Y'all ain't saying it again. Now, you may have a few that may like to beautify things, but for the most part, when you start seeing anything that's very decorative and looks in place, see, a man can build a house, but a woman got to keep it. Y'all ain't saying it again. And think of it, that's why they always used to say, they would say that, you know, you can tell if a woman lives in the house of a man because therefore it looks different.
Yes.
The refrigerator.
That's right. You ain't got no box of pizza, and that's it. And some old milk that's been spoiled.
Full of water.
Come on, talk to me. But all of a sudden she starts getting, she goes to the store, she makes a grocery list. All of a sudden your cupboards are full. Your refrigerator is organized. Yeah. All of a sudden, she got some matching bed sheets. Y'all ain't saying nothing here. You ain't got that comfort even half the last 20 years. Uh-huh. And then all of a sudden, you start going in the closet, it's organized, and things. You come back, you say, well, honey, where is this at? And the reality of it is because your stuff used to be so out of place. But then all of a sudden, she said, I'm bringing some means to your madness. Women, you are important. We don't say it enough. The body of Christ don't say it enough, because the gospel a lot of times is portrayed as a masculine gospel, but it's very feminine. And so what we have to understand, that there is no way possible to expand without women. So you can tell yourself that you are important. I just had to share that. That ain't a part of my message, but I hear the Holy Spirit, so I'm allowing the Holy Spirit to have his way. You have no body ministry without women. We have to do a better job of taking advantage, taking care of them and protecting them. So we have to protect our women. So write this down. The title of the message is called God is Expanding You. God is Expanding You. And my subtopic is Apostolic Imprisonment. Apostolic Imprisonment. I'm going to teach today, and we're going to go there. So if you have your Bibles, I want you, we can stay in that vein, Pastor. I like that. Turn to Mark chapter 4, and let's read verse 26, and we're going to read down. Mark chapter 4, we're going to start with verse 26, and I'm going to start reading. If you do have your Bibles or your mobile apps, you can go ahead and do it from there. If you don't have a Bible, download Bible Gateway app. You can get every Bible there is, and you can follow with us. But the reading implies, and this is what it says. It says, and he said, so is the kingdom of God, as if a man should cast seed into the ground, and should sleep and rise night and day, and the seed should spring and grow up and knows not how. For the earth bringeth forth fruit of herself, first the blade, then the ear, and after that, the full corn of the ear. Verse 29, but when the fruit is brought forth immediately, he putteth in the sickle, because the harvest is come. Verse 30, and it says, whereunto shall we liken the kingdom of God? Or with comparison shall we compare it? It is like a grain of a mustard seed, which was when he sown it into the earth, is less than all of the seeds that be in the earth. Verse 32, but when he sown, it grows up and becomes greater than all the herb, and shooteth out great branches, so that the fowls of the air may lodge under the shadow of it. Read 32 again, but when it is sown, it grows up and becomes greater than all herbs, and shooteth out great branches, so that the fowls of the air may lodge under the shadow of it. That is the reason of the word. Let the body of Christ say amen.
Amen.
So the message is called God is Expanding You. So what I want to deal with, provoke some thoughts inside of your brain. I promise you this, that we will not be before you long, but the Lord gave me this an hour before we came to church. Wow. So as he gave me this, I end up preparing and writing the message down so I can be able to share this apostolic prophetic word with you today. That's why, if you notice, I posted it a little later, because I was going to talk about something else. But the Holy Spirit told me, he said, tell them that I'm getting ready to expand them. So the word expansion, so write that down. Write down the word expansion. Expansion is the action of becoming larger or more extensive. Extensive of a state, territory, by encroaching of that of other nations, pursued as a political strategy. It also means a thing formed by the enlargement, broadening of development of something. Expansion is also defined as an act of getting bigger or something added unto something else. Amen. In the business sense of expansion, is the phase of a business cycle where real gross domestic product, which is GDP, grows for two or more consecutive quarters. Many from it through the peers. Expansion is typically accompanied by a rise in employment, consumer confidence, equity or equity markets, and also referred to the economic recovery. Now, as far as the church growth, it means it occurs in two primary ways. The most common way is transfer growth. So transfer growth is when you have two churches that are separate from the churches, and they come together as one under one leadership, and they create a church. The other one is when the Christian church began to just go out and you soul win, like we've been doing, and you go out and soul win and you win people over to Christ or invite them to come, and then therefore you have expansion growth. Now I'm gonna do with three parts in this, because we have to be able, we're talking on a theme of how to grow, you know, financially and real estate, economically, debt and all that stuff like that. That still will imply into the message. However, what I want to do is provoke some thoughts, because we're going into our new season. I want you to understand that God is in the expansion.
Amen. Amen.
God is in the expansion. So the first part of expansion I want to deal with is I want you to deal with in the spiritual significance, the spiritual sense. What is expansion in the spiritual sense? Now, when you come to Christ and you finally get to know Jesus and you accept Christ as your personal Savior, the first thing that you do is you acknowledge Him. Then we say, hey, you got to be born again, and you become born again, right? Now you're trying to figure out, what do I supposed to do as a new believer? Am I telling the truth? So because what it is a very strange world. When you have lived out in the world, you have done things the way you've always done it, maybe not came from a Christian home or environment, and now you come into the knowledge of Jesus Christ, and you have no clue of what my expectations of what I must do to be able to further the kingdom. All you can do in the short term is tell somebody that I accept Christ. Now, a couple of things that may happen in the time period of that happening. The first thing may happen is you may share that you accepted Christ as your personal Savior. However, many people that is connected to you may not know Him and may cast down those thoughts saying, hey, I don't know what you're doing. God is not real. He's not a real thing. I don't know why you're serving or getting connected up with a white man's religion. Have anybody ever heard that before? And so what happens is you begin to put those seeds of thoughts inside of your brain, and then you start taking those thoughts and you're trying to say, am I making a great decision or a wise decision? Have anybody been compelled with that thought inside their thought life that being a believer or being a Christian is a wise decision? And I'm going to say that is because the reality of it is so many other things, because they will throw things at you like the ancestors, you know, the ancestor doctrine, the ancestor religion. Like, why are you serving a white man's religion? We need to serve, you know, our ancestors. That's our true real religion. Our religion was stripped when they came over as slaves. And so what we did is been indoctrinated. And then we end up adopting their religion instead of keeping our own. Have anybody ever heard that before?
Yeah.
All right, I'm talking to somebody. And then as time progressed, when it was in the 60s and 70s, they had the movement because of so much chaos was happening in an African-American community. Then therefore, the Islamic movement, the Nation of Islam movement, it began to grow. And so as it began to grow, because they began to put things in place, they had men in place and discipline. And so therefore, they started teaching separation. Have anybody seen that before?
Yes, sir.
And so therefore that dominary, the Nation of Islam grew to a massive, and Moors grew, and many other things, fastest began to grow as you began to embark on your journey of becoming a believer. And so let me provoke a thought inside of you. Why do you think that when you become a believer, it becomes so challenging and seem like you have your life became seem like it's a lot more harder as a believer than a non-believer? Because it seemed like, and I've heard people say this, and maybe some of you have said the same thing, my life was a lot easier when I was not saved.
Yeah.
Have anybody said that? Just raise your hand. Let's be honest today. Yeah. This is not a judgment zone. My life seemed a lot easier when I was not saved, when I didn't know Christ. I was living my life. It seemed like I had a great job. I had no problem. I had friends. I could go to the club. I could do whatever I wanted to do. Everything's great. I had a great apartment. Everything seemed great, but as soon as I accepted Christ as a person, as my personal Savior, all of a sudden chaos began to just start to wreck my life. Things start going awry. You start losing things. Things are not happening. You're like, well, I pray every single day. I serve. I come. I do all those things, but all these things are happening. And so then you begin to question yourself whether I made the right decision. Now, this is not my notes. I'm flowing with the Holy Spirit, okay? That's why I'm not looking down, but this is some real thoughts. And so all of a sudden, I'm painting a picture. You go through those phases in life, and so what you do, you have a tendency to start having questions or asking questions to your closest confidants. It may be a wife, it may be a friend, it may be a best friend, it may be a coworker, but you start asking questions. How many of y'all have ever asked questions before? Mm-hmm. But the question that you ask them, you can never truly get answers before, so you didn't get answers. And then all of a sudden, you go to church and you praise God. You may become a worship leader, you may not, but you start going to church and you feel His Spirit, but in the inside, you still feel empty. You feel like I come to church as a duty, but I'm not really feeling the presence of God like I should. And then therefore you start having these questions beside your soul. Is God's presence real? Have anybody ever experienced an emptiness even though they come into the house of the Lord? All right, talk to me. I know I'm with the Holy Spirit. And so as a result, then all these thoughts are being provoked. But the Spirit of the Lord began to tell me, he said, the reason why those things happen in your life is because I'm trying to expand you bigger than your circumstances. See, a lot of people do things based circumstantially. So they move emotionally and circumstantially. So their emotions are driven them to make decisions. So when you go out there, have you ever tried to make a purchase on something and all of a sudden you second guess yourself over and over again? Is this a good decision? That is what they call an emotional driven decision. So your emotions are in the way, but your intellect and your will is compelling each other. And so now your decision making is causing chaos with your inner man. And so your inner man is challenging your natural man. And therefore you can't make a decision. And then all of a sudden you lose an opportunity. That same car you was looking at is no longer there because somebody purchased it, even though you was the first one to talk to them, because you couldn't make a decision because you allow your emotional man to control your spirit man. I always say this, if your spirit man say do something, I always say do it immediately. Somebody say do it immediately. Because when your spirit man is telling you something that's out of your comfort zone, that means that it is God-driven. That is God-driven. A lot of things in life concerning expansion and opportunity is God-driven, but until you get in control of your spirit man and control your emotional man, you can never be able to expand to really to furnish your own life, but also the kingdom of God. We cannot make decisions based on our emotional man. Your emotional man will lead you into a ray. Emotional man will lead you opposite of what God is trying to do. Because your emotions, let me explain something to you. Eve was the emotion of Adam. Hear me now. Eve was the emotions of Adam. The closest thing to the heart is the emotion. That's why they always say men are 85% logical and 15% emotional. Women are 85% emotional and 15% logical. So therefore, most men a lot of times make logical decisions based on the circumstances or what the information is given. And so therefore, I said this in times past that in Pineville, I said what happens is you can have a bill that need to be paid. Y'all remember this. I said a bill that need to be paid. The man knows the bill is due on the 24th. Because it's a light bill, your wife or your woman or girlfriend to keep on emotionally coming at you. Have you paid that bill yet? Have you paid that bill yet? Have you paid that bill yet? And so that's the emotional, because she don't want, because of fear, the emotional side say, hey, I don't want my life to be cut off. But the man is already putting everything in perspective to be able to take care of that. So we have to learn how to trust. Somebody say trust. When God is sending you on a journey to expand you, you have to trust him. Let me paint a picture for you. When Abraham was in his father's house, Abraham had a situation where his fathers and every countrymen served many gods. They had many gods that they served. And so as a result of that, God began to spoke to Abram, and he told him he had to go on a journey. Now, if you've been, you're successful in your kindred with your family. Listen, Abraham was not poor. Abram was not a poor man. So they had abundance of wealth. And the most craziest thing, if you're living with abundance of wealth and resources, all of a sudden you hear something that is unknown to you to say you have to leave your kindreds and leave them and go away from them and serve me. Now, the natural man, they would say to themselves that does not make any sense. And so what you would do is you would start beginning to cast down those imaginations, because that is not God. That's what we would say. That's not God. That's not God. But imagine if Abraham would have ended up listening to those thoughts and saying, I got it all together where I am. God could not number him, because therefore he was stuck in a condition. And sometimes we can be stuck in a condition that seems like we're prospering. But guess what? The limit ability of your prosperity is not greater than God's abundance. Amen. That's some deep stuff. Amen. Your limitless of your prosperity is not greater than God's abundance. Write that down. Your limitless of your prosperity is not greater than God's abundance. God's abundance is greater than your limited prosperity. So what you do is you have your house and you feel like it's going well, but not realizing that God is trying to expand you to greater. Abraham had to follow God. And as he began to follow God, he went on a journey. And even though it was a tough journey, and even though he had roadblocks ahead, God still made provision. Somebody say, God will make a provision for you. God is always constantly making a provision for you. So what we have to understand, even when you don't see it or can't figure it out, God is making provisions.
Amen.
The problem is we don't see the provision happening when it's happened because we are in the circumstances. So what we do is we have what we call circumstantial belief. Write that down, circumstantial belief. Our belief system is based on circumstances. I believe you when everything is going well, but my belief system begins to fail when things are not going the way that they should. Have anybody ever experienced that? That your prayer time is a little bit less when you're going through circumstances, because like you're like, I prayed, and he ain't doing nothing. So now what happens is fear. Somebody say false evidence appearing real. So what it is false evidence appearing real. So your circumstantial things begin to take place, and then therefore it starts tapping into your emotional will, and therefore it takes place of faith. Circumstantials, emotions, all work together. Because when you're in a circumstance, that causes emotions. And emotions end up causing you to have lack of faith. Because your emotions cause you to make decisions because you think upon it. The Bible says what? Cast your cares upon me and I'll do what? Make your burdens light. But what we do is we cast our cares based on our emotions and our circumstances. If we know, and this is something I want to plant into your head so that you can be able to see as I get to the next phase of this message, is this. If you think about, you have to go back. See, what the enemy does, and he's very trickery, he's very clever, right? So what he does, he don't have new tricks, he just have new faces, right? So what he does is this. He will show you the problem. And then he'll make you feel internally that you cannot get out of that problem. But if you actually just pause for a second and give yourself a timeout, somebody need a timeout break. If you know in the game of basketball or in football, when the play ain't the right play or things ain't going right, what did the coach do? He calls a timeout. And some of you need to start calling a timeout in your spirit, man. And so what I want to convey to you is this. Think about all your life of the same situation, even in your childhood, that was a problem or a situation that you have arisen in your life, but you're still here and you made it through it. So don't you think that if he made you through all these years of problems and situations, don't you think God is going to get you through this one as well?
Amen.
But what the enemy does is he shows you the problem, but he don't show you how many times have God made provision for you.
Yes.
The children of Israel got delivered out of Egypt. He literally split the Red Sea, let them walk on dry land, put them in a land right there that was prosperous, even though it was the wilderness. But he said, listen, I'm going to send you to a place flowing with milk and honey. But what they did is the man of God ended up going onto the mountain. They created a golden calf, the same thing they had in Egypt. But God just showed you that if I am capable of causing a whirlwind or a tornado, if I am capable of allowing that the lands become dry across the Red Sea, am I more than capable to bring you to a land flowing with milk and honey?
Yes.
The land of milk and honey was a 3-day journey. It was right across there. They made it to the other side. It was right there. The land of Canaan was flowing there. But because circumstantial and emotional, therefore there were giants. Because you see something in your life that's bigger than where you are, then therefore that becomes a giant. So it may, that giant may that you feel like I don't have good enough credit for me to be able to get a new home. So therefore I shut myself down. That becomes a giant. The giant becomes when your body is beginning to start having all these problems inside this stuff. And then what you want to do is you want to listen to everything that the doctor says, but you want to take the natural resources to make your lifestyle better. That becomes a giant. There's a giant when you know that you're overweight, but you don't want to do what you need to do to start eating better and exercising. That becomes a giant.
Amen.
Because what you do is you begin to see within yourself that it's impossible because you've been living in that conditioning and your emotion is your will has taken control of your faith. Mm-hmm. Imagine this. I have to wander around the wilderness for 40 years and never making it to the land of promise. But because the Bible says that the ones that was 21 years and younger, because they did not have Egypt in their heart. Somebody say Egypt. There's three phases in life. Somebody write this down. There's an Egypt, there's a wilderness, and there's a destiny. There's an Egypt in your life, you will have a wilderness in your life, and you will have a destiny in your life. The Egypt is a place of spoils, but it's also a place of captivity. Egypt is a place of spoils, but it's also a place of captivity. The wilderness is a place where you stay there, but the Lord allowed the wilderness because he wanted humility. Because when you're in a dry place, all you have is trust.
Amen.
God is getting you to a place, even because some of you may be in a wilderness moment in your life. You have been delivered from Egypt, you're in wilderness, and you don't know what's getting ready to happen next. You're trying to figure it out. You have wrote out a plan. You got a business plan. You have watched every book. You have been on YouTube. You have listened to every preacher there is. You have listened to every self-help thing. You have listened to every motivational speaker. And you're still in a valley of nowhere.
Nowhere.
Have anybody done those things? I have got on YouTube, I watch self-help, I've done all those things, but you still seem like you're in the valley of nowhere.
Well,
glory.
Like, Lord, I've heard everything you can possibly can do. I have the resources, but what happens is you're in the valley of nowhere. In the valley of nowhere, that is letting you know that you are in a wilderness season in your life. Because the only way that you can expand, for God to expand you, you must identify where you are. And the body of Christ is right now where they're in a wilderness moment. God has delivered us from Egypt. He has brought us into the wilderness. And guess what we're doing there? We're eating manna. God is still providing for you because guess what? Your daily necessities are being taken care of. But guess what? You are eating manna right now. You are in a wilderness moment. Come on, talk to me.
Yeah.
It seems like everything that you do, everything that you try, everything that you try to do, it seems like nothing is happening for you. That is an indication that you are in a wilderness.
Amen.
But what I want you to understand that it's okay to be in the wilderness. Because when there is a wilderness, you have to understand that you have to change your perspective and your eyesight to understand there is a promised land coming. Because if you understand that the children of Israel didn't forever stay in the wilderness. Now it is up for you to come to the grips and make a decision whether you want to stay in the condition that you're in or you want to move forward and so you can face the giant that's in front of you so that you may go into your destiny. Somebody say, there, I want to go to my destiny. Come on, now y'all following me now. I'm painting a picture that y'all can understand. Because we have to identify. The body of Christ have to identify. And the majority of the body of Christ, as I talk to people on a consistent basis, what I'm finding out is that everybody is still stuck in a desert place. But it's okay to be stuck in a desert place. Now, in a desert place, the great thing about a desert place, because a desert place is not always bad.
Yeah.
Somebody say time.
Time.
In a desert place, it gives you time. So in the time is what do you do with your time in the midst of a desert place? If you have nothing around you, if you have nothing else to do, that means that you have the ability and the time to be able to think critically and resourcefully.
Yep.
Somebody write that down. Critically and resourcefully. In the desert place, God sends somebody to the desert place is because he wants that intimacy with you. He wants you to think very critically. Look at the things in your life that you have done. You have to think critically of yourself. And then what you have to do is you have to remold and reshape yourself. God is the potter. Guess what? You are the clay. He is remolding you. He's reshaping you. But I have to get you to this wilderness moment that I can have the most time, the intimate time with you. Because if you stayed in Egypt, all you would be doing is working. That's why so many people may not have a job at the moment. You're thinking that you're unemployed because your boss didn't like you. You think you're unemployed is because you just felt like, you know, what in the world's going on? No, you're unemployed is because God is trying to expand you to take you to a place that you ain't never gone. I need personal time with you.
That's right.
Because guess what? Wouldn't you rather have time to hear God's thoughts about your life and your future directory than sitting there being at the job and all you can do is focus on work? You're still here, isn't it? You're still here. But you're here is because he loves you enough to let you know that I'm getting ready to expand you as we move forward in 2022. But what I need is your time. So what we have to do is we have to rechange the way we use time. What we do is we feel like we have what we call boring time. Boring time is like because you are routine oriented. Most people are routine oriented. They get up, they do the same thing. They may cook, they may breakfast, they may wash clothes, or whatever it may do, they're routine oriented. So your routines, it causes you to be able to move in a certain trajectory. However, what God is wanting you to do is shake up your routine. Somebody say, shake up the routine.
Shake up routine.
God wants to shake up your routines. Now, what he also wants you to do is God wants you to reproduce. So this is what it says, that God has designed all living things to reproduce, to multiply, and to expand. It is the way that things work, and how much more do he expect from the church? God has given you the ability to reproduce. He's given you the ability to multiply. His ability. The problem is we are not jointly connected. Now imagine if you look at the big successful companies in this world, like a Google or Microsoft or Amazon or different places like that, right? If you notice that all those companies had more than one person that ran the company. When Google got started, he had a partner. They came in a garage, they built the company, they built a platform, they began to expand. Microsoft had five people inside the company to expand. Facebook had the same thing. It just wasn't Mark Zuckerberg. He had three other partners who had played different roles for expansion. If you look at every great company, they had more than one person in expansion. Now, I will say this. Imagine if you do not work at this specific time and all three of the women or four or five or six women, I don't know who don't have a job or who don't, but if you don't, and y'all came together and y'all brainstormed of a creative business idea that y'all could come together as one, how much further could y'all go with the platform of knowledge and the wealth of information that you have?
True.
And what if the men of the church had took upon what you guys decided to do and we undergirded you guys for you guys to get there?
Amen.
Now we're talking God kingdom type thinking.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because what we have not done is we have not protected our women. And so what it is women have ideas, but a lot of times the ideas are shut down. It's because we're focused on our natural things, but not realizing that God has a lot of ideas in them that can be used to be able to further and furnish the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Now, how can they be a Proverbs 31 woman if we're not undergirding them? So you won't hear this on a regular church service because we don't deal with the Proverbs 31. The only time you deal with a Proverbs 31 woman is when the woman is teaching on Proverbs 31. Mm-hmm. But you very rarely ever hear a man teaching on Proverbs 31.
That's true.
But it said even her husband called her blessed.
Right.
It said she worked with her hands. Now, I'm flowing in the Holy Spirit. If you notice, I have not looked down one time because I'm flowing in the Holy Spirit for a specific reason. It's because the Lord is sharing with me is that we have to undergird them. So when y'all have y'all next women's ministry, this is a suggestion, is that you guys or before then, y'all create a text line or a conference line and y'all come up and say, write down five ideas, business ideas that the women have that you would like to do. Then y'all come to an agreement by doing a survey amongst each other, what would think to seem like the best idea. Then it comes to the platform, then the job that you would have to do is then figure out how much it's going to cost, what is it going to take to get that done, and then you propose it for the women that y'all come together as one, but also bring it back to the men and allow us to come together to come up with strategic strategy to be able to undergird that so he can be able to move forth. So now what's happening is now you have a business, but now you have multiple women who's a connected up to them that's having a business opportunity, a place of employment that belongs to them that they can furnish the kingdom, but also furnish their families.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
Amen. Right now, we have a sister church, and I'm going to put you out. You didn't know I was going to do this, but I'm going to do it anyway because this is what I do. Elaine right now, she makes earrings and makes stuff. She has, at 2 o'clock today, on Bonanza, is that right? That you're doing a launch of your product, right? So it's on Bonanza. Now, one thing about that is she's doing a launch of her earrings and her handmade products. I would advise some of you guys to support what Elaine is doing. Elaine is a faithful woman who comes to church, everything. She sows her seed. She pays her tithe. She's always here. That support her to be able to spring forth the business that she has put in place. But also that help her to be able to expand it so she can be able to have more time.
Amen.
Oh, we ain't done yet, cause I'm getting started.
Okay.
So the thing about it is this: is a lot of we've been dealing with business, we've been dealing with different things. And it's expansion time coming. As we understand, as Christmas is getting ready to come, there is expansion. I thank God for the people who's out here who's doing what they're doing. Because we have business owners. If you have a business hand right now, just raise your hand if you have a business. So right now we have 1, 2, keep it up, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of myself. We have 7 businesses in the church. Somebody give the Lord a praise for that.
Good number.
It stands for completion. Now imagine this, is that, and we have 7 now, and then 7 turn to 14. Now, my prayer is that by the time January or February in 2022, that we will have 7 new businesses spring forth at the Christian Heritage Worship Center. Now, I got to talk to Antonio a bit last night and about ideas he had. I'm not going to put it on the social media channel as of yet, but he has a business idea that he wants to put forth for his family.
Amen.
Now, the great thing about that is that his wife had came together and she had some ideas to be able to expand it. Amen. And it's concerning the construction line of things in that way. And so the idea of what we have to do is a body ministry so we can expand is, one, have a sheet out, and maybe we can have it out next week or the week after, to know what is your business. Because the thing of it is we don't know what you do. How can we able to help you for you to spring forth? But we don't know what you do. And I said this before when we was in Pineville. I said, once we know what we do, we have to share that and promote it and to put it out there so we can be able to allow other people to know what you do so we can help further your business. Amen.
Amen.
Other thing it says, Genesis 1:26-28, it says, be fruitful and multiply and let it fall upon the earth. So Genesis 1:26-28, it says, the king is looking for hearts that's like good soil that bears fruit 30, 60, and 100-fold. That's Matthew 13:23. God is looking for somebody who is willing to put a seed into the ground that it may spring forth a harvest. A lot of times we can't be expanded. It's because we don't know how to sow seeds in good ground. A lot of seeds that we are sowing are not in good ground. Our seeds that we are sowing are in not so good grounds. So what we do, think about this. If you sow seeds in a bad ground, do you expect forth a harvest?
No.
So why do we do that? Why do we sow seeds in a bad ground? And I'm going to say this too, and I have to be very strategic when I say this, but it's very clear. Is that every time that something is a need or someone come with you to need, does not mean that you have to fill it.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have to understand, I used this as an example the other day. I have a person that constantly always have a need, right? And they come to me every time they have a need. So therefore what they do is like, and then they say, oh, you have disappeared. Well, I've covered your need for 7 years. Now, that is not my responsibility because I'm a pastor. People feel because you're a pastor, your job is to cover all of their needs. However, no, our job is to help you become self-sufficient that you can cover your own needs.
Amen.
Amen. I can't get $100, $200 requests every week. That is not because of decision that you made in your life. That means that you're not good ground.
Yeah.
And I've always said this. I say sometimes it's not that people have money problems. They have management problems.
Right.
And until you learn how to manage your life, then therefore you're going to continue not to have any money. And I said this to the same person. I said, there is no reason why you don't have any money. If you are on Section 8 housing and you're only paying $200 a month and you have a full-time job, you have a grown child that also works, there is no reason that you should not have any money. What are you doing with your resources? But then you get mad at me. It's because I am tired of giving you some money because you can't pay your light bill. I just sold you a car. We have no dealings. But you're a pastor. Yeah, that's a pastor. But guess what? I'm supposed to manage my house and you're supposed to manage yours.
That's right.
Talk to me, somebody.
Yeah,
so we have to make changes. We have to sit there and say enough is enough.
Enough is enough.
Going into 2022, somebody say enough is enough.
Enough.
And in 2022, for the first half of the year, for the first quarter of the year, I advise you as one of your pastors here to be able to take care of yourself. You have to take care of yourself. Bishop, you can't give out money. We can't do that in the first quarter through 2022. We can't do it.
Amen.
We can't do it. Amen. We can't do it. We cannot do it. Right now, somebody say clean up.
Clean up.
We're cleaning up things in our own life. That means that we've already talked about credit. We've already talked about resources, about budgeting. We've already talked about how to get into real estate. So for us to be able to further the kingdom of God and also further what's in our own life, we have to clean up some things in our own life. Because it starts with self-evaluation. You cannot expand until you begin to clean up things in your personal life. Right now, when somebody asks you for something, what you're going to have to say right now, I'm working clean up things in my own life, and I cannot afford to do that.
Yeah.
Wanda, you can't afford to clean up people's life. I hear this by the Spirit. You can't afford to do it. We can't afford to do it. Taya, you can't do it. Chris, you can't do it. Monica, you can't do it. Corey, everybody, and Teresa, you can't do it. Lady Joe, you can't do it. We can't do it. We can't afford to do it. Hold on. I'm not going through the message. I'm just using this example. I'm not talking about you. I'm just talking about an example. We can't afford to do it. Because what we have to do is we can't afford to be able to take care of everyone else. We have to take care of ourselves right now.
Right.
The Bible says this, and this is very clear. It says this, is that God is looking for a person who has a heart condition for him. How can you move forward if your heart condition is not aligned to his will? See, we are aligning ourselves to our man. We are aligning ourselves to the woman. We align ourselves to everything else but the heart condition of God. That's how you expand. You expand is when you align yourself with the heart condition of God. Now, I got to speed through this because the simple fact is we're running out of time. But I also was talking about an apostolic imprisonment. I'm going to share that with you because that's important. The apostolic imprisonment is a body ministry. And I kind of mentioned it to it before, but we are an apostolic body, right? Because we have multiple gifts inside the body, right? We have many people who operate under different gifts. Now, as a result of that, it's being in an apostolic imprisonment. If you notice that when you have that, you find a lot of ministries, a lot of churches that seems like they have thousands and thousands and thousands of people, right? And you see, you watch them on television, you do all that stuff. And so what people say is that they're where the move of God is. And so what preachers have a tendency to do is that even though they have a large membership, they say that God is here is because we have growth. Mm-hmm. Have you ever heard of that or seen that, right? And so what people do is the smaller ministry have a tendency to sow into those ministry as an undergirding, believing that God's presence is there and that the same fortitude about being jointly connected to them will also cause expansion into their own ministry. That's why you find the TBNs and different things of that nature, the Daystars, that people will sow into those so they can be able to get an opportunity to be able to preach and minister on television so they can get some recognition for the ministry that they have. And so as a result of that, they bark at you to sow and give and so on and so forth. And then as a result of that, you will be blessed. But let me explain something to you. I have to very explain something to you. When you're in an apostolic mandate over your life, that God does not require you to do that. What God is requiring you to do is to focus your energy and your effort on seeking him and hearing his heart. We have to hear God's heart. Because reality of it is, what seems big does not mean that God is always in it. I'm not knocking what's going on, but therefore that does not mean that the heart of God is present.
That's right.
And so what happened is when you start to see challenges arising within the church or the body of the ministry structure, that does not mean that God is not present. What that means is that it's a satanic assignment has been coming against the body. Why? It's because you're heading in the right direction.
Yes.
And so what the enemy does is he calls you to be in prison, so therefore you can't expand, because if the word only got out, if the word only got out, then therefore you can rough up the enemy and destroy the enemy's camp.
Yes.
So what he does is he calls an apostolic imprisonment. I shut the ways of Facebook. I shut the ways of Instagram. I shut the ways of your website. I shut the ways of everything that you do. It's because I'm going to do everything possible to shut down the kingdom of God in your ministry, because I don't want you to expand the word of God that it may get out and change some people's lives.
Yes, yes, yes.
Why do you think all of a sudden we start talking about finances and real estate, and now you having some issues within your body? You the set man over the house. All of a sudden, what did the enemy do? He started coming against your body. You ain't had them problems before.
Nope.
You come and preaching before. All right. But all of a sudden, now we're doing something different, and we're having no more church as usual. And all of a sudden, now people in the body of Christ all of a sudden start having some problems within their body when they start pressing in and coming to the house of God. That is called an apostolic imprisonment.
Yes.
You think all of a sudden now Vernon had a problem with his body all of a sudden out the blue? You all of a sudden now all of a sudden that Wanda, your sister, ended up having to go to the hospital out the blue? Now all of a sudden now everything, everybody started having all these different issues within their body all of a sudden out the blue when you ain't had no problems. That's called an apostolic imprisonment. Because what it is you have a word of God inside of your heart that has to get out. And so the enemy is mad, so he started causing chaotic things so that your voice will not be heard. Because the devil does not want trajectories to change. The devil don't want you to have ownership. The devil don't want you to have abundance. The devil don't want you to have wealth. Because guess what? If you take what God has given you and you align yourself with it and you have resources to do it, then guess what? Therefore, more souls will come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
So what I'm going to start doing is I'm going to start hurting your finances. I'm going to cause unemployment. I'm going to cause frustration. I'm going to cause problems in your body. I'm going to cause you have to go to the hospital to have more bills and more stuff than you ever had before. It's because I'm trying to shut you down from being able to break through from your apostolic imprisonment. See, that's why I said the Holy Spirit gave me that this morning as I was sitting there riding in the car. He said the people of God is stuck into an apostolic imprisonment. He said, but as you begin to pray for today, he said there's a release, man, that will come that break them through and break them from an apostolic imprisonment. The body of Christ does not have to have an apostolic imprisonment. Diana, you don't have to have an apostolic imprisonment because you are so effective. How ironic is the person that getting attacked is the person that ends up holding the money for the house of God? Because that's the resource. The leadership then attacks the person who handles the money. Because the enemy knows if we band together literally on one accord with one sound, with one voice, and one prayer, that nothing can stop us or anything that can hold us down. Hallelujah. It's because God has taken us to a place we've never gone before. But the reality of it is what the Holy Spirit wants us to understand. As we begin to press fervently in prayer, as we begin to pray, and we pray through until we get to the kingdom, therefore there's a breaking, there's a change being broken off your life. There's an apostolic going to move forward. There's a governmental anointing being released that will cause change not only in the city, but it also cause change in the country. But we cannot allow the government, the anointing to happen, because I got to cut you down. I got to shut you down. I got to do everything impossible, empower you to be able to move forward. But God is saying, now listen, I understand that the enemy is there, but I am greater than him. But what I need you to understand, but until the body of Christ come together with one and begin to press out of their comfort zone and press into the prayer and press it and be their love language and their life, then therefore the power of God and his demonstration and the angels on assignment will begin to move, so therefore he can take things out of your consciousness and bring it to the world's consciousness, so therefore he can bring about change into this nation. God is trying to change. consciousness. He's trying to change your trajectory. He's trying to change your heart. But the only way that happens is when you have time in prayer. Prayer is the intimacy. Why do you think people speak in tongues? Tongues is actually mentioned, and the reason why it's there is a gift, because that is a personal relationship, a personal unknown language that you speak into God that the enemy can't decipher.
Yes. Hallelujah.
But what happens is a lot of churches don't believe in the power of tongues because they think that's hocus pocus, but not realizing in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 that they're talking about tongues. When they end up going to the upper room in Acts chapter 1, going to Acts chapter 2, what do? They start speaking in tongues, and tongues came down like cloven tongues as fire, and they start speaking in unknown languages. And there are people who did not know, now they know. So if you was from Mexico, and you were from Trinidad, and you was from Africa, and you start speaking French, all of a sudden, Lady Joe starts speaking French. And all of a sudden, I start speaking in Trinidadian language, or whatever that may be. You may be Haitian, and you may start speaking in one language, and all of a sudden, Shasta starts speaking in your language. And you understand. Why? Because you're speaking in tongues.
Yes.
And the enemy don't want you to know how to speak in tongues. It's because what he want to do is want to shut your prayer life down. I want to shut your prayer life down. I want to shut your prayer life down. You know why? Because if I can shut down your prayer life, I shut down your power.
Yes. Come on now.
Diana is here today because of prayer.
Yes.
Bishop Joe, you're here today because of prayer.
Yes.
So many people are here today because of prayer.
Yes.
But what it is as we begin to pray, as the saints starting to pray, therefore power is being released.
Yes. Glory to God.
Yes, oh God.
Doctors can't find out what's going on. You know why? Because prayer has power.
Yes.
But I got to shut your prayer language down.
Right.
I got to shut your prayer language down. I want to shut your prayer language down. You know why I want to shut your prayer language down? Because if you only knew how much power you got, then therefore God can expand you. God is trying to expand the body of Christ, and he's going to expand it through you. It ain't going to be expanded through no dog or no donkey. It ain't going to be expanded through no elephant. It ain't going to be expanded for no lion's head. It ain't going to be expanded through none of that stuff. It ain't expanded through no golden calf. God is expanding the kingdom through you. But as you begin to fervently pray, see, prayer language, the tongues, is when you get out of yourself. See, when you start just praying, you just praying. But all of a sudden, robo shabamashata. That's now you're getting out of yourself. And you start pressing in from your inner man. And as you begin to start praying through your inner man, things begin to release in the supernatural that will manifest in the natural. God is, somebody say, God is trying to expand you.
God is trying to expand you.
Expand me, Lord. See, the power of the apostolic ministry, the prophetic ministry. See, the Holy Ghost is on me now. See, the power of the apostolic ministry is a governmental anointing. We are sent here to govern. And have rule. But the reality of it is we have to get in position in prayer. Somebody say, posture yourself in prayer.
Posture yourself.
As you posture yourself in prayer and you pray from your inner man, then it flows out of you fervently. Angels on assignment begin to be released because you begin to posture yourself in prayer. Do you know that prayer can bring you to death? You didn't never heard that before. The Bible says that Jesus began to pray and he started sweating great drops of blood because he was praying for you and me. That he started taking on everything that you would ever do in your life. That he was bleeding eternally because he took it on. And your prayer life should get to a place that you pray so fervently that you start feeling what they feel. That you can snatch your loved ones out the fire. You can begin to pray so fervently that all of a sudden your mind's eye begin to change. And you'll start seeing things in the spirit, what's going on in their life. You can pray so fervently to the point that you are literally out of your body and you go right to where they are and you're standing looking just like you, looking like you was them. But so many people haven't tapped into that level because they haven't.
haven't pressed so much into prayer. I press into prayer that I can leave my body and I go into the kingdom and I'm sitting on my knees before God himself, light, and he's beginning to instruct me. That didn't happen by happenstance. That didn't happen by chance. You think all of a sudden I come up here and prophesy and share things with you that I haven't talked to none of y'all about, and all of a sudden they come out? It's because as I begin to pray, I begin to walk and see. God has the ability and the power to change trajectories. You could be going off a cliff and you begin to pray. You could have a loved one going off a cliff and you could begin to pray, and all of a sudden they change their trajectory and change them, put them back on a straight line. Do you know that your prayer has power? Do you know that your prayer has power? Do you know that your prayer has power? Do you know you're here right now because your prayer has power? God, expand their prayer life. Expand their prayer life. That we will be known as a church that prays. We will be known as a church that prays. That we will pray so fervently and so hard to the point that we get God's attention. That when people walk into the sanctuary, any type of demarcation that come against their body has to drop off their body as soon as they enter the door. Do you know you can pray that they walk in a parking lot and they begin to change? Do you know you can pray to literally, that you get God attention, that literally they come into the parking lot, all of a sudden that the crookedness in their body becomes straight? Do you know you can pray that you can literally change your whole future and your destiny? Do you know you can pray that all of a sudden the opportunity that was closed shut, that they weren't thinking about you, will call you on the phone and say that opportunity is open up? Do you know that the God can put you at the tables of the politicians and the political leaders, that they can listen to what you say? That's how powerful your prayer life is. But if you don't pray, you can't change it. See, what the enemy has told you, and I'm closing on this, the enemy has told you is that you can't do it. You ain't amount to anything. You look at your life and you see that your life is not in the situation or the place that you desire or you wanted to be. You say, I dream of having more than what I have right now. I dream of being in a better state. I dreamed of it, but I'm not in the condition. And then all of a sudden, you start looking on the social media channels, and then all of a sudden, you see some of your friends or people you went to school with seem like they're doing a whole lot better than what you are doing. They ain't doing right, but I'm doing right. See, that's a trick from the enemy. Because what it is what you're doing is you're trying to measure yourself with a low level. You cannot lower yourself to a low level if God is trying to give you a kingdom. If God is trying to give you a kingdom, then why would you want a cabin? See, the enemy is trying to give you a cabin mentality when I'm trying to give you a kingdom mentality. I don't want the cabin. I want the kingdom. Come on, talk to me. Somebody say, I don't want the cabin. I want the kingdom. I want the kingdom. I want everything that God has for me. I want it all. I want it all. I want it all. No limitations. I want it all. I want everything that God has for me. I need it all. I need it all. Enemy, you took some things from me. It's okay. You can have that because I want some new stuff. I don't want the 18. I want the 1980 car. I don't want the 1990 car. I don't want the 200, 300,000 miles. I don't want that. God, give me something new. I don't need the problems. I don't need a check engine problem. I need something new. You know what? I need a new home. I need one for my children. Shasta, as you start declaring that to yourself, God is giving you a new home. It's yours. You can walk in it. It's all yours. Somebody say multiple bedrooms. You can have a 6 or 7 bedroom house. You can have 7 or 8 bathrooms. You can have a 3-car garage. It's yours. Don't think that all of a sudden that you all of a sudden you don't went through that God ain't touched with the feelings of your infirmity. I feel the anointing. God is releasing that on your life. And guess what? You're going to have more than that. Because all of a sudden you're going to start getting one house, and then all of a sudden God's going to open the door so you can have multiple houses, and then people are going to start paying the house that you live in. Somebody say somebody gonna start paying rent to you. You all of a sudden think all of a sudden you want to get in the real estate business and all of a sudden you want to start learning. No, that's a God idea, because he had to show you something bigger than what you think you are. Somebody say, God is expanding me. I want you to close your eyes for a quick second. I'm going to share something with you. And this is for everybody. I'm telling you, this will bless your life. And I did this morning. Now, imagine this. Imagine you have a home or you live in an apartment. I don't know where you live, but to think about this, as you begin to close your eyes, imagine when you first get your first apartment or your first house. And when you walk in the house, it's empty. It's empty. There's nothing there. It might be carpet. It may be hardwood floors, but guess what? There is nothing there. There's no furnishings. But all of a sudden, as you begin to close your eyes and you envision yourself. You envision a sofa. You envision a love seat. You envision an end cap. You envision the end tables. You envision a comforter. You envision a fireplace. You envision the mirror. You envision the lamps. Come on, talk to me, somebody. You envision all of a sudden you got a kitchen table. You get up the long table. You envision yourself having a refrigerator full of stuff. You envision a new bedroom set. And as you begin to create those things into the atmosphere, into your vision, then the manifestation of God's creation begin to manifest on from the natural all the way now to from the supernatural to the natural. But until you begin to close your eyes and envision yourself better than where you are, you can't go there. So what God does, God has given you the power to create. God wants you to see. So as you begin to close your eyes and envision yourself further than where you are, God can begin to walk and open that door for you that you can walk into that anointing. Have you ever been in a situation that all of a sudden you begin to ride a neighborhood and you start looking at houses and all of a sudden you say, that's the one? That's the one. Have you ever been to the car lot and you look at the car and say, that's the one? And all of a sudden you say, let me walk inside. So what the enemy does is the enemy wants to put fear that you say, I'm not able. I'm not capable of getting there. My circumstances don't allow me to get there. Why God allow you to ride through that neighborhood? Oh yeah. And have you ever got out the car and all of a sudden you went to that house and they had a for sale sign and it had a picture of the house and tell you how much the house costs? It tells you how much, what the square footage is. Have anybody ever done that before? And they open up and they look and they would go to the neighborhood that they envision a living in and they grab that. And all of a sudden they looked at it and they began to say, it would be nice if I could live in a place like this. Am I telling the truth? The reason why the Lord is showing you that is because what he's doing, he's trying to enlarge you. He's trying to expand your capacity, because what he wants you to do is you can't have it. You're not over there by happenstance. The Bible says that a good man's footsteps is under the Lord. He's ordering your footsteps so you can believe it, so you can receive it, so you can have it. Do you know that God will hook you up and give you the right pieces and all the tools and resources to get that done? God does not have a respect to person. God just don't have a respect for them. He has the same love for you. But until you begin to think about that thing and say, God, I thank you. I thank you for allowing me to ride this neighborhood and grab this. I thank you. And now, Lord, give me the wisdom, give me the knowledge, and give me the understanding to be able to get it done. Somebody say endless resources. Lord is giving you endless resources as we speak. Endless resources. Endless resources. You have to believe that God is giving you endless resources so you can be able to get it done. Bishop gave you a nugget into the kingdom last week. He lived, you gave you $1 million worth of game. You just didn't realize it. So the first thing that I would do is I would take the notes that I got from last week. And then I would sit there and I would review those notes and say, okay, let me start there. Let me get the first class. Let me sign up for that. Let me work my way. And if your husband or wife, guess what? Y'all start working on it together. But at the same time, I want you to start working on your credit together. If you owe somebody, pay them. Stop trying to run from it. Because God can't bless you with further if you can't take care of the small things. You got a big mindset of having something big, but you want to take care of the small things that I've already given you. How can I expand you when you can't? You're not good at it. Some of us need a checkup from the neck up. Stop running from people. people you owe. It's okay. You owe them, pay them. Even if you got to start small. Own up to it. Because if you own up to it. See, what people do is when they owe you something, they run. And then they disconnect themselves, and all of a sudden they get new numbers, they get all that stuff like that. Because you know why they do that? It's because they have an accountability problem. They have a character issue. People have a character issue, and it designates on habits. But I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying this time, he said, I'm the Lord of the habit breaker. The Lord is breaking up. Stand on your feet. We're going to pray and we're going to close. Lord, I thank you because you're the Lord of the habit breaker. You got a habit problem, and you point to yourself and say, I got a habit problem that I need to fix. Because guess what? The only way that you can get there, listen, ain't no judgments on. If you got a habit problem, say, I got a habit. It can be anything. I got a habit problem. But Lord, you're the Lord of the habit breaker. Now, Lord, break those habits within inside of me so that I can be free, that I can be and do what you have called me to do. Lord, you are the Lord of the breakthrough. Now, Lord, I need a breakthrough anointing. You are the Lord of the harvest. I need a harvest to come forth. Lord, I have sown seeds. Now it's harvest time. Lord, I can't wait till the spring. Let it be harvest in the winter. See, that's supernatural stuff. Because, see, the natural thing, there can't be no harvest in the winter. But we serve a supernatural God. Therefore, it can be harvest in the wintertime. So, Lord, I call the Lord of the harvest to bring harvest into wintertime. Lord, everything that you have that belongs to me, my heart is open to receive. So Lord, say, help me to receive. Help me to receive. Some of y'all don't know how to receive, but Lord, help me to receive. If somebody wants to sow into your life, receive it. Don't be like, oh, don't sow. No, receive what they receive, because guess what? The Lord is trying to bless you. That's right. I had a lady say this, and I'm closing. A lady told me this. She gave me $50. I'll never forget this. She gave me $50, and I end up having the in my pocket. I had cut her grass. I went home, and I put it was raining outside. I took my pants off. I threw it in the washing machine, and all of a sudden, the check got ruined. I didn't worry about it because I'm like, you know, I'm blessing her anyway. I came back over here 2 weeks later. I ended up starting to cut her grass. It was an elderly lady, Miss Peggy McCain. I love her. She's like a mom to me, and all of a sudden, she rebuked me. She rebuked me before I even got started. Because I wouldn't knock on the door, I would just cut her grass. She rebuked me. She said, you messed up my checkbook. And I said, well, how? I didn't use the money. She said, because I was sowing into your life, you're not going to mess up my blessing when I sowed into your life. She said, so I'm going to give you the money again. She said, before you do anything else, you go to the bank and you go cash that check.
That's right.
So I took the check, and I left, and I apologized, and I took it to the bank, and I went and cashed the check, and I heard the Holy Ghost. He said, if you're not teachable to receive, then I can't expand you. Because I felt like, you know, I was the mighty man of God. I felt like, you know, I just want to give. And the Lord said, no, you give, but you're going to get in return. You gotta learn. So as you give, expect a harvest. Nobody's going to plant grass seeds down not to have no grass. The spiritual and the natural law works together as one self. If you sow, you receive. If you sow, you receive. If you sow, you receive. Whatever you sow is what you shall get. If you sow a tomato, you're going to get what? If you sow an apple, you're going to get what?
Apple.
Come on. So the law of sow and reap still is the same. That's all tithe and offering is.
That's all. That's all.
See, what we do is we want to make it all deep. It ain't deep. The law is this. Tithe and offering is a simple law. It's a very simple thing. It's all sowing and reaping. That's it. That's it. So, Father, we thank you. We close. Father, we thank you now because you're good. We thank you for the word that God is expanding. Thank you that is me. It's me who you are expanding. You can say it to yourself. It's me who you are expanding. So, Father, we thank you now that you've already done the work.
Amen. Thank you.
We thank you for the apostolic ministry. mandate that you have embarked on our life. We thank you that you're guiding our journey. We thank you that you're keeping us through the week. We thank you that you're giving us blessings that we have never room enough to receive. We thank you right now that you are expanding our capacity to produce. We thank you that our mind's eye is open to receive. We thank you right now that everything that you have, that we're ready for it. We're going into 2022. We're in 2021. We're closing out this year with a bang.
Yeah. Amen.
An urgency and a fervency.
Yes.
Business opportunities being met. LLCs being created. PDFs being made. Yes. Classes are being made. Real estate ventures are being expanded. Father, we thank you now that everything that we need is ours.
Yes.
And we're going to walk into that freshness of it.
Yes.
And God, we give you all the credit because it is so, because your words are truth. And we give you all those things in Jesus' name. Let the church say amen.
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 Thank you for joining us and allowing us in your home.
It indeed was our honor to bring the word of God to you today. May it grow in you richly, strengthen and encourage you.
May the Lord be with you throughout this week. Shalom.
Hello, and thank you for being part of this ministry. One part of our worship that we are excited about is to worship the Lord with the returning of our tithes and planting a seed as an offering to the Lord. We know that this is not a debt that we owe, but a seed that we sow. It leaves our hands, but never our lives. It goes into our future and multiplies 1,000 times more. Please take a moment to return your tithes and plant your seed as your expression of love and thanks to the Lord as we worship Him with our gifts. You may do so by going to the Giverify app and typing in Christian Heritage Worship Center, Pineville, North Carolina. God bless.
Grace and peace, friends. Thank you so much for joining us today for our experience of worship and the Word. We hope that your heart was encouraged and lifted up, and we pray that as you're mixing this Word with faith, that you will see the promises of God being made manifest in your life. On behalf of Bishop Clive and Lady Cynthia Joe, again, we want to say thank you. Thank you for your support, and thank you for joining us as we continue to do life together. We would love to connect with you even after the message is over. Feel free to visit us on our website, www.christianheritageworshipcenter.org. And if you would like to email us, you can do so at info@christianheritageworshipcenter.org. Find us on Instagram at chwc.pineville.nc. And on Facebook, just search under Christian Heritage Worship Center. Until we join again together, we want to say thank you again, and we pray God's continued blessing upon your life. Shalom.